In the lecture outline, I think I have the main points. Of course, there's a lot of detail to fill in between the lines on the main points. The purpose of filtration, as given to you there in the outline, is to remove as much harmful material from the wine as possible, and of almost equal importance, to improve the appearance and the stability of the wine. Now, you have two main types of filtration action. One is screening. Just think of a filter medium as a window screen, and depending upon the pore size, it'll remove particles of a given size. The other main action of the filter medium or filtration is adsorption. If you're using a cellulose filter medium, the first fraction of the wine that goes through is always the clearest because cellulose does have some adsorption action, and as a result, it'll remove particles finer than it can remove by the screening action. Asbestos, of course, is the best filtration medium we have because of its high zeta potential. At wine pH, it is charged very strongly and as a result has a high adsorption capacity. And it'll remove particles that cannot be removed by screening action alone. Now, the factors governing the filtration rate, seven main factors. Naturally, the size of the pores would be the most important factor. In other words, what is the largest particle that can get through your filtration medium? Of almost equal importance, of course, are the number of pores. If you have just one pore in a large filtration service, you're going to get a very small amount of wine through. If you have a large number of pores, then you can have a higher flow rate. Also of great importance is the percent of solids, either crystalline or amorphous, that you want to remove from the wine by the filtration action, and of course the type of the solids. The crystalline solids will themselves act as a filtration medium. If you're filtering out potassium bitartrate deposits, or I should say suspensions in wine, they are crystalline in nature, and they will not plug the filter because they'll act just like the filter powder itself. They do not deform. The amorphous particles, proteins, gums, and so on, are amorphous, which means that they can be squeezed, changed in shape, and so on. Bentonite is another amorphous type of particle. And if you'd ever try to filter a tank of wine that's been bentonited and you get down too far and start picking up some of the bentonite, you'll find that your filter will plug immediately because the fact of the material you're trying to remove is amorphous. It pushes into the openings in the filtration medium and plug it almost immediately and plug it tightly. The rate of deposition of solids is also quite an important parameter. Of less importance is the flow characteristics of the liquid. As your usual rule, table wines will filter easier than the sweet dessert wines because of the lower viscosity, it flows easier. Filtering area, naturally the larger the filtering area we can present, the greater the quantity of wine that we can put through in a given length of time. And pressure difference, and I'll have quite a bit more to say about pressure difference because it is a very important parameter in filtration. Now the types of filtration. Rough, fine, polishing, sterilizing. We use rough filtration to prepare the wine for a fine filtration. It's true that we can take a fairly cloudy wine and filter through a small pore size cake, but we're going to have a greatly decreased flow rate and also a greatly decreased filtration cycle. So it is better from an economic standpoint, both in cost of wine, labor, and filter powder, to rough filter. There are a number of grades of filter powder that are available. I'm speaking now to diatomaceous earth, varying in the size of pores that they will provide in a cake, from fairly large size pore openings to quite small size pore openings. So it's wise to use a filter potter that will give you a rough, or give you a fairly open and fairly large pore size, and then follow up with a fine filtration later on. Use a fine filtration following refrigeration because of the fact that ordinarily when we refrigerate a wine, more or less of the particles we're trying to remove, potassium bitartrate, brilinaceous matter, color tannin, polymers and so on, will remain in suspension rather than to deposit out. And these particles are in suspension and of a size large enough to be removed by filtration because they are at a lower temperature. If we just rack instead of filter, then when the wine warms up, these particles will go back into solution again. And unfortunately, will probably later on deposit in the bottle. So that's why it's necessary to use a fine filtration following refrigeration. We use a polishing filtration. As the name would indicate, we want to give the wine a bright appearance, a polish, just prior to bottling. And we use a sterilizing filtration instead of hot bottling. Sterilizing filtration is preferable just prior to bottling to remove the yeast and hopefully most of the bacteria that are present in the wine to render the wine microbiologically stable in the bottle. Now the types of filters. We have two general types. A depth filter. And the best example and the most commonly used example of a depth filter is the diatomaceous earth powder filter. We're on a supporting frame. We deposit a layer of the diatomaceous earth. The other type of depth filter is a pad filter. Pads are made of a cellulose, asbestos, or mixtures of the two, and they are formed in the shape of a pad, generally about a quarter of an inch thick. The second main type of filter is entirely different from this first type I've been discussing, and that is the screen or membrane filter. And the screen or membrane filter relies entirely upon the size of the opening to remove particles. It has no adsorption capacity. It also has practically no capacity for removing any appreciable amount of particles. It will hold back anything larger than the pore size. Any questions at this point? Am I going too fast for you? Yes?
Could you go over the difference between the diatomaceous earth and the pad filter again?
The diatomaceous earth filter consists of a plate and frame. A plate on which the powder is deposited. Actually, the plate is first covered with a cloth and usually with a paper. And then the powder is deposited on this. The plate is so constructed that it has channels for the wine to collect and discharge ports after it goes through the filter and medium. And the filtration medium is the powder itself. Whereas the pad filter is formed in the shape of, or in the form of a pad, usually about a quarter of an inch thick. It's like a sheet, only it's about a quarter of an inch thick, and varying in size from a few inches up to as much as 2 or 3 feet, either square or round. Any other questions?
I didn't catch the reasoning behind the asbestos adsorption.
It has a high charge, almost from the charge of the particles that you want to remove from the wine. So it's a charge attraction. Is there another question?
Does the diatomaceous earth filter by using the actual holes in the diatomaceous earth itself, or by just, like sand would filter, by just using the holes between the particles?
It's the holes between the particles. The reason that these diatomaceous earth fillers have a great capacity for removing solids is that the solids, two things. One, they are thick, and there's a tortuous path through. The pore size of a diatomaceous earth filler is non-uniform. It varies from very small to very large, but due to the fact that the wine must follow a tortuous path through, the particles are largely removed due to the distance that the wine has to travel through the filler medium itself. This, of course, is not true of the screen or membrane type of filter. Now I want to discuss the characteristics, the advantages and disadvantages of different types of depth filters. Diatomaceous earth or powder filter, plate and frame. This is the one on which the powder builds up. It has a rough surface, so that as the wine goes through the powder, it can discharge through the discharge port. And powder is fed continuously by a slurry pump into the filter as the wine is being filtered. That way you are presenting partially new surface to the wine at all times. If you do not feed powder in, fairly shortly, the surface of the powder would be completely plugged. But by admixing new wine with a new powder, with the wine being introduced into the filter, you keep presenting a partially new surface, and you keep filtering until such time as the space between the plate on which the powder is built up and the spacer plate is completely filled with powder. One of the biggest advantages of the plate and frame type of filter is it presents a large filter area. I think the largest plates that any of the wineries are using now are 4 feet square, and they may have as many as 60 plates in one filter. So the surface area presented is tremendous. Because it does have a large filtration area, it has a high filtration capacity. As much as 30,000 gallons an hour can be put through some of the large filters. Another advantage is that it will handle wines of all degrees of clarity, ranging all the way from cloudy to brilliant wines. If you're working with a cloudy wine, you just increase the amount of powder that you add. If you're working with a very clear wine, you add much less powder. That is the rate that the powder is introduced during the filtration cycle. And the filler medium is inexpensive. Diatomaceous powder is relatively cheap. So that's the reason why the plate and frame filter, or variations of the powder filter, are the most widely used for the usual filtration operations in the processing of the wines up to the bottling. It has disadvantages, though. The cloths, which are necessary for the plate and frame filter, become torn. They need to be laundered because they'll become plugged after a while, and they can be a source of infection. These fillers require high pressure. They're difficult to automate. They have high labor costs in setting up the fillers and in tearing them down, clean them. And they tend to leak wine. So there you have both advantages and the disadvantages of the plate and frame filter. The pressure leaf filter is a closed chamber with a series of metal plates, that is, plates covered with screen so that they're porous. They can either be vertical or horizontal. They're completely enclosed, which is one advantage over the plate and frame, yes?
What is the name of this?
The pressure leaf filter. Like the plate and frame, they have a large filter area, again up to 30,000 gallons of wine per hour and a high filtration capacity. Again, like the plate and frame, they'll handle cloudy to brilliant wines. And as a used diatomaceous earth, they're using an inexpensive filter medium. And one of the big advantages over the plate and frame is that they are easily automated. Now, we have large pressure filters in the wine industry that are completely automated. The powder is fed in automatically. The pressure is monitored. The clarity is monitored. When the pressure rises to a certain point, the filtration cycle is stopped. The wine is blown out. And then the screens are cleaned automatically, drained, and the pre-coat is set up again automatically, and the filtration cycle is commenced again automatically. So for that reason, they do have the big advantage over the plate and frame in that they can be automated, which means that the cost of operation is considerably decreased from the labor standpoint. And, as I said earlier, they don't leak because the screens are completely enclosed in a chamber. Disadvantages like the plate and frame, high pressure. And the capital cost of this type of filter is considerably greater than that of the plate and frame. Another disadvantage is that this fine metal screen covering these pressure leaves after a while tends to become clogged. And where it becomes clogged, then the filter cake will not form on it. And when that happens, then you usually start to get leakage of unfiltered wine through these areas. And when that occurs, then the plates must be cleaned, which can be done either mechanically or by treating with a warm alkali solution.
The plates get clogged themselves?
The screen covering the frame of the plate. See, there's a fine metal screen over supporting bars, you might say, that provide the surface on which the powder deposits.
What kind of powder?
Pardon?
What kind of powder is used in this one?
Diatomaceous earth, same as the same as the plate and frame.
As we're looking at that picture you put on behind us, these are the horizontal racks.
Right. They can be the horizontal or vertical. I just drew this vertical. They're also horizontal ones. And these are just supports to support a fine metal screen, which in turn supports the filter cake. You don't use cloths with this. You deposit the powder directly on the screen. The third type of powder filter is the rotary vacuum. As the name would indicate, this is a rotary type of filter, a drum which rotates. The powder cake is built up to its complete extent before the filtration is started. The cake of powder may be anywhere from 2 to 4 inches thick. On the larger models, it requires some 3 tons of powder to form the cake. The rotary vacuum, on the periphery of which the powder is built up, just think of that as a cake of powder, rotates in a pan. And the wine is introduced into this pan, and the filter dips into the wine as the drum rotates, and it gets down here into the wine. A vacuum is applied, and the vacuum is the force that drives the wine from the pan through into ports here and then later discharged to the tank. In addition to that, there is a called a doctor blade, a very sharp blade, which is adjusted to peel off a very, very thin layer of this filter powder on each revolution of the drum. And that way it keeps presenting a new surface to the wine being filtered.
This wine goes from the outside of that drum into the inside.
That's right. This is the pan in which the wine is contained. The drum dips into the pan. The vacuum is applied when it goes into the wine, and it pulls the wine through the powder into the ports inside the drum. Yes?
When you say the vacuum is applied when it dips into the wine, what you mean is the drum is segmented?
Yes. The big advantage of the rotary vacuum filter is that it can handle material that would almost immediately plug a plate and frame or a leaf pressure type filter. Because of the fact that you can filter material, in fact you can filter leaves through this filter here. Material is so heavy in solids that it almost immediately plugs the cake as it dips into the wine here. But on every revolution, you're scraping off that plug and presenting a fresh surface of powder. So that's a big advantage of the thing. You can filter unfermented juice. You can filter racking lees. In other words, things that you could not even begin to filter by a conventional plate and frame or leaf pressure type of filter. The disadvantage is a very high capital cost. For 3,000 gallons an hour of white juice, unfermented juice, you have an investment of some $150,000 to $180,000. And the capacity, as I mentioned, is quite low, only 3,000 gallons an hour for filtering that type of material. The amount of wine one can filter through in a given length of time will depend entirely upon the solids content. And so the higher the solids content, the less wine can be filtered in a given length of time. Filtering white unfermented juice, they're used largely for that purpose here in this state. They have a filtration cycle of about 20 hours. They can run for about 20 hours on this one cake, and at a rate of about 3,000 gallons an hour. So you can filter about 60,000 gallons on one cake set up, 3 tons of powder. And it's about 4 hours to clean them up and get them set up for the next cycle. It's a high powder consumption because, in fact, you need a lot of powder. You're scraping off powder all the time, and to enable you to handle these high solid content juices or wines. Another disadvantage of them is that they do aerate the wines, and they tend to strip the wines of the aromatic constituents because of this vacuum that's pulled. Particularly true if there's not too high a solids content in the material being filtered, then the stripping action is pronounced. Any questions on these powder filters?
Can the powder be cleaned up and reproduced?
Yes, but the Johns Manville Company and the Cellulo Company have done a lot of work on reclaiming powder, and the net result is don't do it. Because they cannot use the reclaimed powder straight. They have to mix in fresh powder with it. And the cost of reclaiming the powder and the extra cost involved in using it makes it just about a break-even operation. It's only recommended where there's a disposal problem that is disposing of the used filter powder. Yes?
Is there any definite evidence for asbestos being a
carcinogen? Is there any definite evidence? asbestos in the lung that is inhaled is a definite, proven carcinogen. That answer your question? No argument on that one. I might say that where we use asbestos in filtration, that is either as a tightener in a powder filtration or in the form of pads, that there are certain regulations promulgated by the federal government which one must follow to avoid the possibility of inhaling asbestos fibers. Okay, pad fillers. Advantages. They'll give a finer filtration. They have both screen and adsorption capacity. Particularly true of the asbestos pads or those containing a high proportion of asbestos. And they can be adapted to sterile filtration. So they'll give a higher polish than is usually attainable by use of powder fillers, even where asbestos is used as a tightener in forming a pre-coat. Disadvantages of a pad filler. The cost of the filler itself is high when one compares it with a powder filler on a gallon or per dollar cost. In other words, the capital cost is a great deal greater because of the low filtration capacity of the pad filler compared with the powder filler. The pads are costly also. Yes?
Is it possible to reclaim the pads?
Not that I know of. There's too much chance of infection. I've known of cases where people would use the same set of pads in a bottling room for several days up to a week and get by with it for a period of time, and all of a sudden they'd have a very bad either yeast or bacterial break or infection in their bottled wines. And they cannot be cleaned to be reused again. You can only use them on bright wines because, excuse me, they have a low capacity for removal of solids. They don't have the depth to hold solids like a powder filter does. Low flow rate, and they will not guarantee a sterile filtration. Now, for many years, all we had to achieve a sterile filtration was pad fillers, and we developed techniques that worked pretty well. It required a lot of care, a lot of labor in operation, but we did achieve, most of the time, sterility, or at least a low enough population of yeast that we did not have trouble using pads. But they are still not a guarantee of a sterile filtration because the pads, the porosity of the pads varies tremendously over a very wide range because you visualize a pad being made but putting asbestos cellulose fibers together and pressing them out into a sheet like that. So you have no control over, or I say very little control over the size of the pores that these pads are going to offer. You can test that for yourself by holding the pad up to the light and seeing the variation in the amount of light that comes through the different areas in the pad.
Does anybody use put onto sterile pads?
That is the system we use when we're using pads for sterile filtration. Diatomaceous earth on the pads. Did anyone use earth, diatomaceous earth with pads? I said yes. When we're using pads for sterile filtration, the diatomaceous earth was applied on the top of the pads. Now, I want to talk about a very interesting type of filter, the membrane filter, M-E-M-B-A-R-A-N-E, membrane. That is entirely a screen filter. The size of the pores is rigidly controlled. There are two main types. One produced by the Millipore Corporation, that's M-I-L-L-I-P-O-R-E, which is the first one that was made available to the beverage and food industry. And the membrane is made of cellulose, usually cellulose acetate. And they'll absolutely guarantee that if you buy a 0.65 micron membrane, that no particles larger than 0.65 will go through. And the guarantee is good. Because the largest opening that is presented by this membrane is 0.65, or 0.8 or 1.2 or 0.45, whatever size that you want. So the usual membrane porosity size that's used by the wine industry is 0.85 or 0.8, I forget which it is. Because yeast run in size from about 1.2 to 0.22. So if you choose a 0.85, you have a pretty good safety factor to remove yeast. 0.85 will not remove all of the bacteria, however. So the chief advantage of the membrane type of filter is that it will absolutely remove all particles above the size specified. It has a number of disadvantages. It's only used for sterile filtration, just prior to bottling. High capital cost of the equipment. And the membranes, that is the millipore membranes, are expensive. And they're difficult to clean by back flushing. Or you can practically forget about trying to clean these membranes. The millipore filter, I said, is a screen filter. It is a screen filter because it'll absolutely remove all particles above a certain size. It is also an in-depth filter, though with a very, very thin membrane. But there is a tortuous path through the membrane, even though it's a very thin membrane. And that's another reason why it's almost impossible to backflush and clean it, because you can't flush out the particles from inside these tortuous paths. Nasty can only be used on polished wines. The wines must be brilliant because the filter has absolutely no capacity for removing particles. It is insurance against a yeast infection starting in your bottled wine. And if you use a small enough membrane size, a small enough pore size membrane, you can also remove the bacteria, that is the lactic acid bacteria. It is very widely used. Membrane filters are very widely used. Millipore is the most commonly used one. But a recent advent in the field of membrane filtration is the nucleopore. Membrane. This is a screen filter also, but quite different from the millipore in that it is a polycarbonate. It's made from polycarbonate. Sheets are made. They're subjected to bombardment by irradiation. And wherever these particles hit, they weaken the polycarbonate film. After the bombardment, it's put into an etching bath, and wherever these particles hit, a hole is formed by the etching. So it is a true screen filter. It is not an in-depth filter as the millipore is. And it's much easier to backflush and reuse because all the particles are either trapped on the surface or they go through the holes, period. The membrane is about 10 millimicrons thick. And there are a great number of openings, some 20 to 30 million pores per square centimeter, depending upon the pore size. So you might think of this as a screen that has about between 70 and 80% open area. Again, like the millipore, it will not work on anything but highly polished wines because it has practically no capacity for holding trapped solids. Again, it's insurance that you're going to attain sterility in your wine if it's used properly. Again, like the millipore, high capital cost for the equipment, membranes are costly, and a low flow rate compared with a powder filter or even a pad filter. Yes?
Do they come in different sizes or just one?
There are different sizes. There are square, round.
Different pore size.
Yes. The commercially available are from 0.2 up to, well, as high as you want to go. The range of interest to the wine industry is 0.4 up to 1.2.
in the manufacture, how do they change the pore size? Etching time, is that right?
Etching time in the case of the nuclear pore. And how they attain the correct pore size of the millipore, I have the slightest idea. That's a trade secret.
You mentioned the flow rate in the nuclear pore, so it was slow. Was it slow in millipore as well?
It's slow in both. The nuclear pore will, no. The flow rate is equivalent according to pore size. Any questions on these membrane fillers? Well, in choosing from these different types of filters, naturally you're going to use a powder filter for your bulk filtration, because it'll do the job that's required for bulk filtration, and it's by far the least costly. Use a pad filter for polish and a membrane for sterilizing. Those are just the three things you have to remember about your choice of filters. Now a few words about operational considerations. Naturally, use only fillers constructed of non-corrosive materials. Stainless steel is the best. A number of the plate and frame fillers were made from aluminum alloys. They pit badly, but fortunately, they usually do not pose any problem with aluminum clouding of wine because of the fact that such tremendous amounts of wine are filtered through, and the amount of aluminum picked up is not enough to cause any clouding problems. Some of the plastics are good. Ebonite has also been used. On plumbing, and this is very important, you want no dead ends, because dead ends are a very good source of infection. It's very difficult to clean, to sterilize. Yeast and bacteria will build up in there and contaminate your wine. You want a minimum of turns because you want to reduce the pressure and the difficulty of pumping through the filter. With filler pumps, this is also important. You want a filler pump that is compatible with your filtration capacity. In other words, you want a filler pump with the same capacity as your filter. You want a variable speed filter pump, because it's important to be able to adjust the flow rate. Also of great importance in a filter pump is that it be a positive displacement, because the positive displacement pumps are required for the high pressure, though you can use twin centrifugals and achieve the same effect. Also, the positive displacement pumps are usually less susceptible to the introduction of air. Their packing gland system is better. They do not act as aspirators when you're pumping wine through them. For pressure filters, the powder fillers, you need slurry pumps to pump the slurry into the wine flow going to the filter. And you want the same characteristics in the slurry pumps that you do in your filtration pump. Good packing glands, variable speed, and positive displacement. Another thing to remember is that all powder filters should be air vented. Anyone tell me why? Well, this is a plate and frame filter, all interconnected. You introduce your wine here at the bottom, it rises up like this. And unless the top of your filter is air vented, you'll compress air in here and you won't coat part of your filter. And then when you start your wine filtration through there, the air will gradually work out, but then you have bare places, non-coated places, and you'll have leakage of non-filtered wine. Something that is commonly forgotten, but not anymore. You can operate at a constant flow rate with initial low pressure. In other words, the recommended way of filtration is to start out at a constant low flow rate, which will be a low pressure because you have not plugged up your filtration medium at the start. And you keep increasing the pressure and maintain the constant flow rate. That you will usually achieve the best results. On a plate and frame, I said cloth, paper next to the cloth to protect the cloth, make it much easier to clean the filter after the filtration cycle. You just peel off the paper and the powder comes with it. Select the proper grade of asbestos for the job that you want to do, or proper grade of powder, I'm sorry, for the job you want to do. And if you're doing a fine filtration with powder, then when you form the pre-coat, admix fibrous asbestos with a pre-coat, which will serve to tighten the pre-coat and will help to remove a great deal more of the finer particles than you could remove by a straight powder. And use filter medium that's low in calcium and iron. At one time we had a great deal of trouble from taking up excess calcium and iron from the powder, but now we no longer have that problem since it's brought to the attention of the suppliers of the powder. They are careful to treat it so that we do have low calcium and iron. Leaf pressure filter. Select the proper grade of powder for the particular job. And here, if you want to use asbestos, you put on a pre-coat of powder and then the asbestos on top of the pre-coat, because you have a fine metal screen there on which the pre-coat is applied. And if you put asbestos fibers on top of that screen, you'll soon plug them. So that's why you put powder on first, and then the asbestos, and then start your filtration cycle and start feeding powder through. Pad filter, again, select a pad for the job required. There are a great range of average porosity sizes of pads, so you can have anything from a fairly coarse filtration to a quite fine filtration according to the pad that you select. Inspect the pads for uniformity, because they can vary greatly in the range and porosity of a so-called given average porosity size pad. Again, use pads that are low in calcium and iron and copper. At one time we had some problems with pads because they're using copper equipment for manufacturing the pads, and we were getting excess copper in and then picking it up with the wine. It's a good idea to circulate a 1% citric acid solution through the assembled pad filler prior to starting wine filtration, because these pads do impart a taste to the first wine that goes through. So it's much simpler to circulate a 1% citric acid solution, rinse out the citric acid solution with water, and then chase the water with wine. A membrane filter. Before you start filtration and after you finish the filtration, check for breaks using the bubble test. Now, when to filter. Do not substitute filtration for stabilization clarification. Remember, all you do with filtration is to mechanically remove particles. And you have quite often material in the wine that you want to get rid of that you cannot remove by filtration, and that requires the addition of some type of clarifying agent to react chemically or otherwise with the constituents in the wine to form particles large enough to settle out or to be able to remove them by filtration. So do not substitute filtration for clarification. Filter after clarification and pasteurization. I gave you the reasons earlier why the recommendation is to filter after clarification and refrigeration. Use filtration rather than pasteurization to control yeast in bulk storage. If you're unfortunate enough to have to bulk store some slightly sweet wine and the yeast starts to grow, use bulk filtration to control the yeast rather than pasteurization. Filter also for polish purposes and to attain sterility at the time of bottling. Now, any questions on filtration before I go on to centrifugation?
Could you comment a little on effect on quality?
Filtration properly conducted does not have any appreciable effect upon the quality of the wine. Improperly conducted, it can greatly damage the quality. Aeration is one of the biggest damaging quality factors in filtration.
You said something about starting the filtration, constant flow rate, lower the pressure, increasing the...
You start at a low pressure because of the fact that you have not plugged your filter when you start. You start at a low pressure due to the fact that your filter cake is completely free of plugging particles at the start of the filtration. But because it becomes plugged, more or less plugged as the filtration proceeds. And to maintain the same flow rate is necessary to gradually increase the pressure. Any other question?
Do you comment on the different needs of filtration between red and white wines?
The only difference is that the white wines are more susceptible to aeration, and the white wines are easier to filter than the reds.
You don't think there's any adverse effects in filtering the white wines?
Not if you don't aerate it. There is in filling a red wine because you can remove pigment if you use too tight a filtration.
You don't think it does anything to the flavor?
If you don't aerate it, you won't be able to tell the difference. I mean, the physical screening action has no effect upon the quality. It's aeration that's the big danger in filtration. Any other question?
What is the short filtration cycle for number two?
For number two?
Right, I'm going to filter. Is that?
You mean filter after clarification or refrigeration?
Yeah, do not filter wines that have a short filtration cycle.
Oh. A large plate and frame filter can run for, up to 24 hours. The short filtration cycle would be 2 or 3 hours. Any other questions?
I'm sorry, that didn't make sense to me.
A lot of things I say don't make sense to me either.
The sentence says, do not filter wines which have a short filtration cycle.
Right. In other words, the cycle is from the time you start the filter until the filter becomes plugged and you must break it down, clean it up, and start the filtration cycle over again.
What do you do with these wines?
With?
If you don't filter them?
If you don't filter them?
Right.
Well, you clarify them before you filter.
Oh, to...
To clean them up. No, it's asinine to try and filter a real cloudy wine. Because of the very short filtration cycle. The only time you filter a real cloudy wine is if you're reclaiming wine from racking lees, fermentation lees and so on, and you use a rotary vacuum filter. Any other questions? Well, we didn't quite make it to centrifugation. We'll start there next time.